Are you assured of the fact that you have a home in glory? If you were to die today, do you know that you would spend your life in eternity? I'm talking about life after this life. Do you understand that? Do you know that? You ought to be assured of the fact that if you leave, you've got a home in glory. You've already got to fix it up. You already know where you're going. Christ has guaranteed you that you have a home in glory. Now, we make a lot of preparations for our physical home, but we need to make some preparations for our eternal home. I wish I had a witness here. And so that's what it's all about. You know, making the preparations to be ready to go home. You don't know when God may call you home. I've been around long enough to see people not even make the first year of their birth. And then you see people make 100 years. But God is calling everywhere between the first and 100. And so you need to be ready when the Lord calls you, amen? And when we give the invitation, it's a time for you to get ready. It's a time to say, Lord, I want to be ready today. I want to be ready and I want to be assured of my eternal salvation. Can you say amen? Amen. And God is good all the time. We've been doing a series called Pick Up the Pieces. Amen. I got to hear myself a little better. I've been on program a little while now. You're going to get me adjusted here. Get me adjusted as much as you can. Amen. And my voice is not all that I want it to be. Sometimes because I get a little bit too excited. Amen. Amen. But God is good. I want you to look at the third chapter of Jonah. We've only got one more trip into the book of Jonah. We've been in Jonah talking about running to nothing and surrendering to everything. We talked about from the bottom up, from the bottom up, from the bottom up. But I want to venture in Jonah chapter 3 because I think there's something very interesting in Jonah chapter 3 as well. God does something unique. Most scholars see it as unique in the Old Testament. And he does it in the life of Jonah, but it leaves for us a biblical model of what God will do when you turn to him. And if he did it for Jonah, and where Jonah was, he can do it for you. Maybe where you are right now. And so when we deal with a series like Pick Up the Pieces, you got to be careful that you don't allow spiritual piety to slip in. Because you're trying to gauge where you are based on where somebody else is. And you're not gauging where God wants you to be. No matter where they may be. It's kind of like Peter when the Lord told Peter, you know, Peter, feed my sheep. He said, what about John? God says, that's none of your business. I want you to feed my sheep. And we're kind of like that today. Yeah, we've got things that make us feel good about where we are or where we are not. And what we need to do is begin to examine our own personal lives in areas that may not be quite all that together. Have I got a witness here? I mean, you might have it together in one area, but God wants you to pick up some pieces in another area. And I think that's very important for me to state that in the onset, because God has a way of speaking to us, and he that has an ear to hear. Now help me now. Not just you got an ear, but you got an ear to hear what the Spirit is saying. So what is the Spirit saying to you and what is it saying to me may be quite different depending on our individual circumstances. But let God speak to you about where you are. Amen. Jonah chapter 3, I want to read a couple of verses in your hearing. Really, you know, we actually deal with two units of thoughts from verses 1 through verse 4 is the first unit of thought. Verse 5 starts a second unit, but I want to connect that because I want to say something in this message concerning that. Now look at verse 1. I want you to read this. Matter of fact, I want to take you to verse 10, chapter 2. Stay right there. You're in Jonah. Verse 10, chapter 2. Chapter 2, verse 10, brother. So the Lord spoke to the fish. We may say a whale, but the Bible just says fish. Amen. And it gurgitated Jonah on to dry ground. He got somewhere he can plant his feet. I want you to watch the text. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and preach to it the message or the proclamation that I tell you. That's God speaking. So Jonah arose and went to Nineveh according, hear the text, to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city. I think that's a reference to its populace as well as to some extent its size. A three-day journey in extent. In other words, not a three-day journey to Nineveh, but a three-day journey around Nineveh. Are you thinking with me? All right. And Jonah began to enter the city on the first day's walk. My God. Then he cried out and said, yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. Yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be smashed. God is calling for something. And God's judgment is upon you, Nineveh. So the people of Nineveh believe God. Help me, Holy Spirit. That's probably one of the most beautiful sentences in the book of Jonah. So the people of Nineveh believed God, proclaimed a fast, and put on sackcloth from the greatest to the least of them. Can you hear that text? I want to talk about making the most of your mistakes. Making the most of your mistakes. God, our Father, we plead the presence of your Holy Spirit to speak to us as individuals. Take us all, Lord, in our own private chambers and sit down and counsel with us, Lord, about where we are in life. And then, Father, allow us to hear what the Spirit is saying to us. You're not condemning us, but you're asking us to come back to you. And so, Father, I pray that someone would be able to get a glimpse at their situation, but most of all, a glimpse at the Savior who's calling. Thank you, God, for the kind of grace that you have provided for all of us in our time of need. God, we give your name the praise. I be the preacher. Speak to us today in Jesus' name. Come on, say amen. Amen. Making the most of your mistakes. Mistakes are like Hurricane Lily. Something we hope to avoid or never come our way. Hoping not to suffer the damage of what a mistake can bring like a hurricane does, such as Lily. Messing up our lives, rearranging our plans, untimely interruptions, and the cleanup of all the mess of what mistakes can do in our lives like a hurricane. But you and I both know mistakes are like the night. They will find you somewhere. No matter where you live or lodge, the night will find all of us. The reality is most of us will make mistakes. And maybe I need to stop right there because I believe we can get farther if we would recognize that ain't nobody in the room that has not made a mistake. If we could just get over that fact and really get on to the business of how we can make the most of our mistakes. Because the reality is we've all have made mistakes, but few see the benefit or the ability to bounce back from a mistake they have made. Instead of making the most of our mistakes, we let our mistakes make the most of us. We have pity parties. We are sad. We feel defeated because we've made a mistake in life. We feel the boundaries have been drawn around us, and they only tell us, you know, just how far we can go because we made mistakes in life. As long as you are living and breathing, you can continue to put one foot in front of the other. As a matter of fact, We admire people who made the most of their mistakes. Walt Disney was broke several times and he had a nervous breakdown before he became famous. How about Albert Einstein, that genius? He flunked math. I wish I had somebody. How about Henry Ford? Yeah, listen, he was broke before he was 40. And many of us are driving Ford cars today. You see, God sent his best preacher to Nineveh. That's right. And Nineveh received Jonah there for one day. God sent his best preacher to Nineveh. Even Jonah, God's best preacher, made a mistake. This text tells us that when mistakes are made, how we can make the most of them in order to change our lives. This text tells us when we make a blunder, how God can turn it into a blessing. This text tells us when we make a mistake, how God can turn it into a masterpiece. This text tells us that when we're in the valley, how God can give us victory. This text tells us that when we get in trouble, God is still able to give us triumph if we turn and look to him and allow him to help us when we have made mistakes. Well, the real question is, how can I, preacher, make the most of the mistakes I have made in my life? I'm not willing to tell my mama. I'm not willing to tell my daddy. I'm not willing to share with my best friend. But I do want to know how I can make the most out of my situation right now. You can make the most of your mistakes by, number one, if you look there in verse 1. By making the most of a second chance in God's presence. Help me, somebody. Listen to the text there. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time. My. You see, the object lesson is to get back on your feet. That's what God is saying. God is saying, get back on your feet. The Peterson translation says it like this. Next, God spoke to the fish. Next, God speaks to Jonah. And God spoke to Jonah a second time. Get up on your feet and get on your way. And if you're going to make the most of your mistakes, you've got to stop having a pity party. You've got to get up off of your backside. You've got to stop bowing your head down. You've got to begin to look up and understand that if God has given you breath, there is a bright side somewhere. And so God says you don't have to return back to your former glory. Quit thinking about the car you used to ride in. Quit thinking about the house you used to live in. Quit thinking about how good of a job you used to have. Just get back up on your feet. That's what the text says. You see, Jonah's biggest problem was he simply could not get on his feet. Jonah was out of control because he was not under control. He wanted to flee from the presence of God. So he was out of control. It's not getting back to the bling bling. It's not getting back to the fat payroll that was in your pocket or how big your bank account was. God wants you to get back up on your feet. I wish I had a witness here. You've heard people say he's not on his feet, which means he's sick. You've heard people say he's lost his footing, which means he is stumbling. You've heard people say he can't seem to get on his feet or get his feet under him, which means he is unstable. And Jonah was spiritually sick. He thought he could flee from the presence of God. Jonah was stumbling. He was falling all over the place. Jonah was unstable in his ways. And what happened to Jonah the first time? Jonah made a mistake. And why did he make a mistake? He tried to do the impossible. He tried to get out of God's presence. Jonah tried to run away from God. And from that point, he went down. And many of us are just like that. We want to go places God is not. We want to say things God is not in. We want to do things God will not never lead us to do. I mean, we're trying to remove God from our very existence. We don't care about what God says. We're going to do our own thing. And God says, whatsoever you sow, the same shall you also reap. I'm not Mark. If you get out of my presence, you're going to get out of control. You need a little God in just about everything you do. I wish I had somebody. And so what happened to Jonah? Jonah began to take a journey down because he kept making mistakes. Look there in chapter 1, verse 3. But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish. Hear the text from the presence of God. He went where? Down. And that's what happens when you start removing God out of your life. You start going down. He went down to Jaffa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare. Listen to this. When you start making mistakes and you get out of God's presence, you start paying to go down. That's what the text says. He paid the fare and he went down into the ship to go with them to Tarshish from God's presence. He started down. He paid his way to go down. He forgot about God because while they were on top of the ship praying, Jonah was sleeping. And you know what happens to a Christian when you forget about God? You become spiritually unconscious about the things of God. When you ought to be praying, you're sleeping. When you ought to be in Bible study, you're watching TV. You become unconscious about the God you are serving. You're on your way down. Everything seems against you. I can't get nothing right. My husband ain't right. My spouse ain't right. Ain't nothing right at home. Ain't no home cooking at home. Ain't nothing right on the job. My body seems to be falling apart. You are going down. And then you start justifying yourself. You says, I just made a few mistakes. If nothing changes, you know, it really can't get worse. We start making excuses about going down. And Jonah had lost his footing since he was fleeing from the presence of God, which meant he was out of control because he was not under God's control. And all you need to do to get back on track is to regain your footing. And so the Bible says God gave him a second chance. But the reason I read verse 210 is to show you Jonah has not been on his feet. He was in the stomach of a fish. But the Bible says that God was willing to do the miraculous even though he made a mistake. And the Bible says the fish vomited him out in order for him to get his footing on some dry ground. Don't miss it. Don't you miss it. God is giving Jonah a second chance. You know the word second is usually an adjective. But here it is used as a noun because it is just as good as the first chance. I wish I had a witness. Sometimes God gives us a second chance in marriage. It's just as good as the first chance. Sometimes God gives us another job. It's just as good as the last job. Now God is giving us some more money. It's just as good as the money you used to have. But your mind is on the first time you had it when it ought to be on the second time. A second chance is distinct from the first chance because God is giving you and me a whole nother opportunity. A whole nother opportunity to get it right in our marriage. A whole nother opportunity to handle our money right. A whole nother opportunity to get it right on a fresh start at a new job, in a new post. He's giving us a whole nother opportunity. You know what some scholars say? That when you see this second time, it's spiritually vague, but it must be seriously valued because God gave it to him. In other words, when you read the Bible, it's not many times God grants a second chance, but here the Bible is clear that Jonah, although he was really disobedient to God, God gave him a second chance. And maybe somebody's in here today, you know that bullet just missed your head. You know the doctor had written you off. You know, if you really didn't wake up, you would have ran into that person, you know, that you were driving by. But God gave you a second chance. You got to be careful that you value the chance that God has given to you. Listen to me. Jonah had fallen into distress, chapter 1. He had experienced death's door. He was out of control. He had reached his lowest point in life. The text literally says Jonah had fallen into the pit. He was at a place in life could nobody reach him but God. I wish I had a witness. You see, sometimes God will put you in a place in life that nobody can reach you but him. And you understand better than anybody else, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, good God Almighty, I wouldn't have got over last night. I would not have woke up this morning. If God wasn't watching out for me, I would be gone. And that's exactly what Jonah understood. The only reason I'm standing here today is God has given me a second chance. Listen to the text. God gave him a second chance in his presence. Not just a second chance to get up. Not just a second chance to eat a meal or to have a job, but in the presence of God. God's presence equates to three things. Let me give them to you. Number one, salvation. We use that word. People say, well, Pastor, what does it mean to be saved? Let me give you another definition for salvation. Salvation means to experience God's highest blessing. That's what it means. It means when you are unsaved, you have been ushered out of God's blessings. But when you are saved, you are then ushered into God's highest blessings. When you are unsaved, there are things that interfere or interrupt God from intervening in your life. But when you are saved, nothing can interrupt God's blessings in your life. And so if there's anybody here today, you say, what does it mean for you to be saved? It means for you to be able to accumulate and receive everything God has for you. Two, security is found in God's presence. You see, when he got out of God's presence, he went down. He got in a violent storm. He was tossed overboard and was about to drown. And the fish swallowed him up. He was literally on the brink of death. Every day he lived outside of God's presence, he was gambling with his life. But when you're in God's presence, come what may, from day to day, because you understand that God is in control of the storms in life. You understand that God is in control. It doesn't matter how high the water gets, or how the wind blows, that God has his hand on your life, and nothing can happen to you without God's permission. Salvation, security. But watch this now. When you're in God's presence, it's a second chance to get in God's presence. Listen to me. When you're in God's presence, you get on your feet, it means sanctification. It is the experience of a new level of living. And when we look at Jonah in chapter 3, he's much different from the way he was in chapter 1. Because he's living at a new level. You see, people would say, I looked at my hands and my hands looked new. I looked at my feet and my feet did too. I mean, I had a new way of walking. I had a new way of talking. You know, I wasn't saying the things I used to say. Now you find me in the church talking about hallelujah to God. Now you find me in the church giving God praise and glory. What happened? God sanctified your life. Put you on a new level of living. You're not living at the same level. You're doing things differently now. How do you make the most of your mistakes? You can make the most of your mistakes by number two. making the most of a repeat encounter of life's position. Look at chapter 3, verse 2. The text says, now this is God speaking, don't want you to miss this. Arise, he's on dry ground, brushing that seaweed off him, you know, wiping himself off, you know, getting a clue to where he is, getting his bearings. God says, arise, go unto Nineveh, that great city. Listen, and God says, now you fell out of the office of preaching, but I'm going to put you back. So it's a repeat encounter with life's position. Jonah, you made a mistake while you were a preacher, but I'm going to put you back in the position of preaching. Now, here's what I want to say to you. We've got to understand that when God gives us a second chance, he doesn't necessarily have to put us back in the same position. But we are witnessing the grace of God in the text. Are you going to think with me? And so the text says, listen, go preach unto them the preaching that I bid you. Now, here's the object lesson. Jonah, this time, cut it straight. I wish I had somebody. If you really gonna make the most of your mistakes, this time, cut it straight. Now, don't get to shucking and jiving like you used to. Don't get to perpetrating like you used to. Don't keep telling them same old lies like you used to. Don't keep running with them same old perpetrators that you always been running with. Cut it. Somebody gonna think with me. The Peterson translation says, this time Jonah started straight off for Nineveh, obeying God's order to the letter. He obeyed what God said to the letter. You see, the fastest way to a point is a straight line. And see, what we need to do is start walking straight. Just straighten up and fly right. God has given us a second chance. We don't need to keep on shucking and jiving. We don't need to keep on doing the same old things we've been doing. Straighten up and fly right. I got somewhere to go. I got things to do. I got people to see. I ain't got time for what you do. We don't get anywhere because our paths are crooked. They're crumbling and they're circular. We're doing what Billy Preston said. We just going around in circles. Billy, go around in circles. That's all we're doing. Going around in circles. And God says, I've got somewhere for you to go. I've got some people for you to see. I've got an assignment on your life. I see some value in you and I'm giving you a second chance. Look at the text. I'm just excited about what this text says, because when you get a repeat encounter with life's position, you should do it a different way. Now, notice Jonah in chapter 1, verse 2. Listen, same thing is going to be said. Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, preach against it. Look at verse 3, right there in chapter 1. But Jonah, instead of going to Nineveh, went the other way. And sometimes we're just like that. God has told us what to do. Instead of going the way God has told us to go, we go the other way. Now watch the text. Go over to 3, verse 2. God talked to him again. Arise, go to Nineveh, and do some preaching. But this time, he decides, based on what he's been through, that I think I'll go to Nineveh. This time, he decides, I think I'll cut it straight. This time he says, I'm not going to shuck and jive with God. I can't play no games with God. God knows where I am. He sees me in my bedroom. I'm not going to play with the Lord. I'm going to do just what he said. Now watch this text. He says, look, watch the text. He says, so Jonah got up and he started walking to Nineveh. And the text says he did it according to God's word. Now look at that little word, word. That word, word means he conducted his business another way. You see, when God gives you another chance, you ought to do your business another way. I wish I had somebody. The word means he conducted his occupation, his acts, his manners another way. He didn't go with the same old friends. He didn't hang out in the same old places. He didn't have the same old attitude. He left all those hang-ups, habits, and hurts behind. He got up and he had business on his mind. I'm gonna take care of God's business. And if I take care of God's business, God will take care of my business. Help me, somebody. Mistakes are not your station in life to be marked. Here I stand. Do not enter. Just because you didn't make it the first time, try it again. You didn't pass the test the first time, try it again. You didn't make it in the first relationship, try it again. You didn't get the job the first time, try it again. Don't let nobody turn you around. I wish I had somebody. As one person said, low aim, not failure, is a crime. Some of us just aiming too low. You need to quit aiming low. Try it again. It's not how badly or how many times a person makes a mistake and gets knocked down. No. But it is getting up no matter how many times you've been knocked down. Do it again. I missed. Do it again. I didn't make it. Do it again. They pushed me back. Do it again. Try it again. Keep on trying. You need to write a new definition of success. Success is trying. I wish I had somebody. One popular song, you know, we used to listen to it. I tried that love thing for the last time. How did you get here? Come on, you ought to act like you know it. You're in church, not God looking at you. Nobody's supposed to be here. I tried that love thing for the last time. You know what that sounds like? That sounds like a person whose mistakes are making the most of them instead of them making the most of their mistakes. I'll never give up on love, no matter how knucklehead he was. Never give up on love, no matter how many games she wanna play. She messed up a good thing. You need to say it like the Commodore. Settle. Honey, good times. Hey, hey, I'm about to feel my help here. Never felt so good. Text says, Jonah re-entered life, verse 3, with more energy than before. That's what you got to do. You got to go at it again. This time, try harder. Go at it again. This time, try harder. He did in one day what it takes most people to do in 3 days. Jonah began his preaching quest in one day. One day, he made the most of his mistakes. Some scholars believe that the gastric acids of this great fish had bleached or mottled Jonah's body. Mottled Jonah's body. He was now bleached and bright like an albino. And the Assyrians heard what he was saying. 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. But not only did they hear what Jonah was saying, they saw what happened to Jonah. And because they could identify with what happened to Jonah, they recognized God had given Jonah another chance. That Jonah had messed up and we messed up. But if we believe and trust in the Lord, God can give me another chance. We often try to hide our mistakes. But if we get healed from where we've been hurt, if we get healed from our hang-ups, if we get healed from our habits, we can have a testimony and not a testophony. I wish I had somebody. We can have it because God will do it in our lives. Is anybody going to help me here? I'm about to finish. Listen, God will give you a second chance to get back into his presence. He'll give you another chance to re-enter life's opportunities. or to life's position. But finally, let me tell you this. If you're going to make the most of your mistakes, making the most of your mistakes by making the most of your opportunity to progress. As long as you are living, as long, let me tell you, I got to say this, the black folk. As long as you living, you got time to progress. I don't care how long you've been doing what you've been doing. You know, you always done it that way. You know, I don't know no other way. As long as you living, you got time to progress. Don't you get stuck in the mud. Don't you let pitiful people impede your progress. Don't let your habits hang you up. As long as you're living, you've got time to progress. Oh Lord, today, what's the object lesson? Get motivated from your mistakes. All of life is about individual choices and opportunities. And Jonah made the choice of seizing the opportunity, of striking the iron while it's hot. He made that choice. Look at verse 3. Verse 3 is Jonah's reaction. Let me let you hear the text. To what God said in verse 2. God said in verse 2, Jonah, get on your feet. Get on his feet. Because if God said it, I believe it, and that settles it. Really, if God said it, that settles it, whether you believe it or not. But if he said it to you, it ought to be a settled issue in your mind. And so the Bible says, so Jonah arose. Life begins to change when you seize the right opportunity and you make the right choices. Don't let your mistakes master you. You master your mistakes. People say experience is the best teacher, but I say the experience of others is the best teacher. You ain't got to smoke no crack to know that crack will get you out of your house and home. You ain't got to go on no drinking binge to know that drinking will give you cirrhosis of the liver. You ain't got to do that. You ain't got to know that you can mess your marriage up by not communicating because you've seen others not communicating. You need to learn from the experience of others. Get motivated from your mistakes. How do you get motivated from your mistakes? You need some inspiration. And Jonah had some inspiration. He had some information. And he had initiation. That is what we see in Jonah's life. He was inspired by what transpired during his mistakes. You know, he was inspired, watch the text, by distress. Just give me 10 minutes. He was inspired by distress. He was inspired by going down. Listen to me. Lean over carefully. He was inspired because he was right at death's door. He said, my life doesn't need to be here. Why am I here? What am I doing in this position in life? He was inspired by being in the pit. In other words, like Fannie Lou Hamer says, Jonah was sick and tired of being sick and tired. Are you sick and tired of being sick and tired? All you got to do is seize the opportunity and make the right choices. Jonah had reached his rock bottom, and now he decided to reach up. Because when you reach your bottom, you can't do nothing but reach up. He was inspired by the headaches. Somebody help me here. He kept on bumping himself up against the wall. And the first bump didn't mean all that. But he kept on bumping himself up against the wall. And he got a headache in the way he was doing things. He was inspired by his heartaches. And for all of your mistakes, God has a miracle for your mess. I wish I had somebody. God has some inspiration for your issues. In other words, he fell, but where he fell was a refining place in his life. God did more through his failures than he did through his success. When you have some heartaches, has anybody had any heartaches?
had some serious headaches. You start to understand that I don't need to be in this situation. I don't need to be doing this thing. This person is no good for my life because my heart aches every time you hit the door. God did through Jonah, through his mistakes, more than he did through his success. Not only did Jonah have inspiration, he had information. Jonah knew God. He knew what God can do. When you read this book, I Ain't Got Time, he knew God would answer prayer no matter how low he fell in life. He knew God would, listen, if he looked to God, God would look to him. He knew that while he was slipping away in life, if he would pray to God, God would answer that prayer. Jonah knew he was not going to look to any worthless idols. Read the book. If he was going to get out of the mess he was in, he had to look to God. He had the right information. But you need initiation. Just can't be inspired. Just can't get preached to. You got to get up and practice something. And that's what this text is all about. Verse 4, and Jonah began to enter the city. See, it's hard to break from your history. And initially, you've got to start your journey. And the journey of 1,000 miles begins with one step. You see, when you break from your history, you're headed somewhere. And Jonah breaks for his blessing. He begins to go to Nineveh. You've got to begin somewhere. And where you begin, God can pour bountiful blessings in your life. The greatest story in the New Testament is this story in the book of Jonah. It's a story of a preacher who has messed up his life, but God gives him a second chance. And it's a story of a city whom God is about to destroy, but God gives them a second chance, all because they take some initial actions. You've got to start somewhere. It's all about initiation. You've got to strike out. You've got to do the right thing. You've got to sow a new seed. You've got to turn over some soil. You've got to take on a new attitude. Accept a new challenge. Get your feet in the water. Cut it straight. You've got to be motivated by your mistakes. You can make the most of your mistakes if you remember that God gives a second chance. If you remember that God allowed you to re-enter into life, and whatever area God allows you to re-enter into, seize your opportunity to make progress in your life. You got to be like the mule who fell into the well. I'm finished. Fell into the well, and his owner made several attempts to get him out. Called for his neighbors to assist him to get him out. But after several attempts to get the mule out the well, the owner decided he would seal the well and cover the mule up alive. So they went and got some dirt and some shovels and started to throw some dirt on the mule back. And as the dirt hit the mule back, it was poundfully pounding on the mule back. But you know how mules are, they're just stubborn. They just kept shaking that dirt off. So he would throw some more dirt in the well. He kept shaking the dirt off and stomping the dirt beneath his feet. And no matter how painful it got, the mule just kept shaking the dirt off and he kept stomping it beneath his feet. And after he kept shoveling the dirt in, the dirt that pounded on his back became his pilot to lift him up to higher ground. What am I saying to you? Every now and then we fall into the well of mistakes. And we can be covered by the dirt of our mistakes. But if we realize that if we shake the dirt off, no matter how painful it is, and stomp it under our feet, the same thing that's falling on our back can be our pilot to higher ground. God is some kind of God. The very sin that carried Jesus to the cross, and Jesus died on that rugged cross, he nailed our sins to the cross. Satan thought he had him because they took him to the grave and he stayed there all night Friday. Stayed there all night Saturday. The devil was having a party because they thought they had Jesus. But the same thing that the devil thought he had that would hook Jesus was the very thing that Jesus used against him. Because on that third day morning, he got up with all power in his hand. The devil nailed him to the cross. our sins, took him to the cross. But on that third day, he declared victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. You got to shake the dirt off. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Shake it off. It hurts. Shake it off. Stop it beneath your feet. Yeah, you made mistakes. Yes, you fell into the well, but shake it off. And the same painful dirt that was falling on your back becomes your pilot to higher ground. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I'm going somewhere, Pastor. Not gonna let my mistakes hold me back. It hurts. And if I'm not careful, my mistakes will try to cover me up. They'll try to bury me alive. But I'm not gonna allow that. I'm gonna shake it off. Pat it under my feet. Let it be my pilot to higher ground. Does somebody want to go to higher ground here today? And that starts with Jesus Christ. They took him to a cross. They nailed him there. Put him in a tomb and thought they had him. But the very thing that they thought they had him in, he came out on higher ground. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Pastor, I want to make the most of my mistakes. I want to get back on higher ground. Where do I begin? It begins with a second chance in God's presence. Allow God to come into your life and he'll make the difference. He'll give you all the blessings you need. He'll provide all the security you need. He'll put your life on a new level. You say, preacher, I want to start that today. Nobody's going to embarrass you. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed, everybody. Saints of God are praying. Nobody's going to embarrass you. This is between you and God. Shake the dirt off. Pound it under your feet. And go to higher ground. I want to start with Jesus today, Pastor. That's you right where you are. I just want you to stand. Not going to embarrass you. Heads bowed, eyes closed. We're going to pray a simple prayer. I see you. Not going to embarrass you. A simple prayer. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Some people are looking at me, but you need to be praying. Allow people a chance to have a personal relationship with God. Nobody's going to embarrass you. You say, Pastor, I want to make a brand new start. You stand. You stand. I'm going to start with Jesus this morning. I see you. You stand. I'm going to start with Jesus this morning. Stand. I see you. I'm going to start with Christ this morning. Come on. Don't you wait. Not all the time God grants another opportunity, but when he does, it's valuable. God may be giving you an opportunity this morning. You may be waiting on what the judge may say. You may be waiting on what the doctors may say. You may be waiting on what your boss may say. You need to hear what God has to say. Let him do something in your life today that you need done in your life, in your soul today. God, I want your presence in my life. Stand on your feet. I'm not going to embarrass you. Not going to embarrass you at all. We're going to pray. I see you. We're going to pray a simple prayer. Everybody's going to pray the same prayer. Stand, I see you. Everybody's going to pray. We're all going to pray it audibly. We're all going to pray it out loud. And through this prayer, if you trust Jesus as your Savior and as your Lord, if you believe he died for your sins, he got up on the third day, he will save you today. October the 6th, 2002, you will be saved. You will leave with a new relationship. You will leave with forgiveness of all your sin. You'll leave with peace within. You'll leave with the assurance I talked about of your eternal home. You stand. I wouldn't pass that up. You stand. Don't pass it up. Don't pass it up. I see you. Don't pass it up. Let's pray. Simple prayer. Everybody's going to pray audibly, out loud. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, everyone. Heavenly Father, I open my heart to you today. Because I recognize that you are a God of a second chance. I made my mistakes. I've fallen in life. But I ask today that you would pick me up, turn me around, place my feet on solid ground. Give me another opportunity to get it right. And I promise you that I will cut it straight according to your word. I open my heart to your son, Jesus Christ, as my Savior and my Lord. And I receive the forgiveness of the cross of Christ in my life for all of my sins. Today, October 6, 2002, I confess with my mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. And I believe in my heart that God has raised him from the dead. And based on your most holy word, I am saved. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You may be seated. I'm forgiven. I've got peace within. And I've got an eternal home. I told you I wasn't going to embarrass you.
I set out on a narrow way many years ago, hoping I would find true love along the broken road. But I got lost a time or two, wiped my brow and kept pushing through. I couldn't see how every sign pointed straight to you. That every long lost dream led me to where you are. Others who broke my heart, they were like northern stars, pointing me on my way into your loving arms. This much I know is true, that God blessed the broken road that led me straight to you. I spent just passing through, lying to have the time I lost and give it back to you. But you just smile, take my hand. You've been there, you understand. It's all part of a grander plan that is coming true. Every long lost dream led me to where the broken road that led me straight to you. hope the days come easy and the moments pass slow, and each road leads you where you wanna go. And if you're faced with a choice and you have to choose, I hope you choose the one that means the most to you. And if one door opens to another door closed, I hope you keep on walking till you find the window. If it's cold outside, show the world the warmth of your smile. But more than anything, my wish for you is that this life becomes all that you wanted to. Your dreams stay big, your worries stay small. You never need to carry more than you can hold. And while you're out there getting where you're getting to, I hope you know somebody loves you and wants the same. But you never forget all the ones who love you and the place you left. I hope you always forgive and you never regret, and you help somebody every chance you get. Oh, you find God's grace in every mistake, and always give more than you take. But more than anything, yeah, more than anything. This life